behalf of the family, I thank you all for coming today to celebrate the life of Ted Wertz. We're going to have some congregational singing. So when the words come up on the board, it's time to sing. We're going to open up with In the Garden. And so I'm going to walk off the stage and we'll do that first song. We come today to remember the life of a husband, a father, a grandfather, great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather, just great-grandfather. Let me pray this opening prayer from Paul. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. And we ask you, Lord, to join us as you're already here to comfort us, to remind us that you made that promise that you would never leave us, never forsake us, and you have held your promise true with Ted. As we go with through these speakers and through words and songs, we do it to remember Ted, an act of worship to you. Thank you, Lord, for loving us and giving us life through Christ, and it's in his name I pray. Amen. Now, I've only known Ted for about a year and a half, and I can tell some stories, but I can't do stories right. I don't have enough information. So we're going to have three speakers that's going to speak first. We're going to have His friend Ron and his friend Erskine and his son Trent are going to speak. And then I will, we'll have a little open time, 15 minutes for if you have anything that you'd like to speak after that. But I'll introduce you there. So, Ron, if you would, please.
Is that about right, Dave?
Thank you. Good morning, friends and family. I understand we're also live streamed, so those that have tuned in, welcome. It is my privilege and honor to be able to speak some today about my most loved, one of my best friends, and I'm just honored to be able to do that. I'm very unextemporaneous, and let me emphasize the un. I made a number of notes, and I think you'll be glad I did, because I may wander off into, who knows, never, never land. We all know how... Thanks, Dave. I'm nervous enough without having to do all this. Thank you. All right. We all know how difficult it is to say goodbye to our family and friends. Even though it's only temporary, we know that we can be reunited with Ted, where he is now, in that majestic presence of the Lord and basking in heavenly glory. I only got to know Ted for about 10 years. Selfishly, that was not long enough. I needed longer. But God's will is sovereign. So today, and in days to come, we will remember the time we did have and got to spend with Ted. He and I were truly instant friends. Ted was like that. In every way, he invited me to be his friend. And I jumped at the chance. Who wouldn't? We enjoyed so many activities together, as did so many of you here today as well. Ted was such a positive guy. Literally every activity and time spent with Ted and with Roz were just excellent times. And I mean that, just excellent. So I'm going to mention a few of those activities in the limited time that I have. First, small group gatherings here at Sun City West Christian Church, where we would study, have Bible studies, we would sometimes review a book, we'd sometimes just tell stories. At the conclusion of those meetings, though, we usually ended by going out for a group dinner somewhere, and especially at a restaurant where they served oysters. The man loved oysters. There were also Bible studies led by Justice Andrew Gould, where we would meet weekly, and those were just great times as well. Golf. I mentioned golf. What a game. A mixture of fun and frustration, especially the frustration. Ted and I were the only ones in our group who would more than once smoke a stogie or two. And Mike Brooks would always say, when we're driving down the fairway, you guys look like you're in a diesel golf cart. But we did enjoy that. I think Ted probably drove me around for at least 10,000 miles in his golf cart. And all I did is contribute by just not giving me a hard time when he'd hit a curb. We also got to travel to a number of places together, like the Breeders' Cup and some other tracks, to watch our beloved thoroughbreds run. Those were special times as well. We had a chance to go up in the mountains in the summer to get away from the oppressive heat here. We'd go up there in groups of us and just get away and have just a ball, just sitting and talking and sometimes playing some golf up there too. We also had a lot of social gatherings. Almost every week we would be playing dominoes or cards or just hanging out. He was a guy you liked to hang out with. I could mention a few others as well. The other night I was trying to fall asleep, and I kept thinking of all the positive things that I know about Ted. And I made a list. I couldn't sleep. I made a list. I won't have time to share all of these with you today. However, let me just mention a few of those things that I found so wonderful about Ted. First, he loved his family. I think as much as anybody I know loved their family. And he was very, very proud, but not in a arrogant or haughty way. It was in a more of a serene and just glowing kind of way that he talked about his family, that when we saw pictures. In fact, he got this almost Mona Lisa smile sometimes, and I knew he was getting ready to talk about his family. I got to share, you've seen some of the pictures up here today. Every time he'd get a new video or a photo or whatever, and we were together, he'd pull those out so we could see them. And he just loved bragging, if you want to call it that, about his family. We smiled and laughed at so many of those. It's just wonderful. He also had a wonderful sense of humor, as most of you would know. One of my most precious memories was him having a conversation with a telemarketer. Now, I don't even turn on my phone when a telemarketer calls, but he enjoyed that. And he, by the time the telemarketer got off the phone, Ted knew whether this guy was married or not, whether he had children, did he go to church, where did he go to church, and a whole wealth of information. I think at that point, Ted could have sold him a pot-bellied stove or anything. It got reversed. So just so much, he's always ready to laugh. Another thing was he's so interested in other people. He would always turn things to about how other people in the family are doing. And I thought that was just wonderful. His depth of knowledge about so many things, we could have conversations about all kinds of things. He was just so well-versed. He was humble. He was confident and wise and had no ounce of judgmentalism or anything, but he's just so humble about himself and his family. And kindness. He was a very, very kind person to everybody that I was ever around him. And that was just, these are just a few of the things that I found amazing about Ted. And I was trying to think, is there anything negative that happened when I was with Ted? The only thing I could think of was that after we'd been playing golf together a while, one day I was having a bad day, more than one bad day, but on this particular day, I think I topped a couple of shots, and then I hit a shank. Golfers know what a shank is. And he turned to me and he said, "Keep your head down, you're looking up." That's probably the meanest thing Ted ever said to me. So I will try to keep my head down on the golf course. But when I look up and I see the wonders and the beauty of the world and what we've had a chance to live in, and I was thinking of the song that Andre Crouch wrote 25 years or so ago called "Soon and Very Soon." And the words are, "We're going to see the King." Ted's there now. We've been promised, for those of us who have love the Lord and accepted him as our Savior, our Lord, we are promised many things. And one is that there will be mansions and there will be banquets. And my hope is that when I get there, that I'll get a room really close to Ted's, and that I'll get to sit at his table. Thanks.
I'm Erskine Skates, minister here and minister in Indiana. Ted and Roz moved in to our town in 98, moved in on West Pecos Lane. Well, I had already gotten acquainted with West Pecos Lane because a couple came to the church here in late 1994 named Joe and Peg Poe. And I remember distinctly when Joe came in, I asked him, I said, what is your name? And he said, Joe. I said, well, what is your last name? He said, Poe. I said, Joe Poe. And he said, yes. I said, what's your wife's name? Peg. Peg Poe. I said, I can't believe this. Well, they and Ted and Roz were very close friends, and only a couple of doors apart on West Pecos Lane. They had moved here from Flat Rock, Indiana. So we had a lot of things to talk about because he graduated in 1949 from the high school in Flat Rock. I graduated from 1949 from a high school in Colorado, Western Colorado, near Grand Junction. I preached, though, in Rush County while I was a graduate student at Butler University. And the Flat Rock River runs right through Moscow. This congregation grew to about 150, but in 1955, in March, with some ice still on the edge of the river, I stood in the river after a revival meeting and baptized 33 people in that cold, icy water. And I would kid Ted, I says, they're probably still dirty by the time it ran through Flat Rock about 24 miles south of there. We became friends. And just as Ron played golf with him, I played golf with him even more than you did. And we had a wonderful time with that. And every New Year's Eve, Ted and Roz would invite us to come over with Joe and Peg and have a New Year's Eve meal together. We always look forward to that. We went through the highs and lows of church life here for 25 years. He was a golfer and a good one. Had really unusually good touch around the greens. He could chip and putt about as good as anybody we played with. But we rose to fame as a pair in the fall of 22 when we sang together for the Friday Night Follies. We sang Home, Home on the Range. We sang that together, and then we sang together, I'm Back in the Saddle Again. Da, 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 da. Then they had us join them again this last November on the 17th and the 20th, where after 3 months of practicing, good heavens, can you imagine practicing for 3 months? Just to sing two little old songs. And what we sang on a night on Broadway was, I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy, and you're a grand old flag. And we did this at the close of the program. Ted got the best line in when we stumbled up onto the stage. He said, I'll bet most of you would have gladly paid more than $5 just to see two 92-year-olds trying to climb up those stairs without falling. He was a Christian in his faith, in his attitude, in his life, in his actions, as has been expressed by Ron eloquently. We'll miss him deeply. We miss him now, we'll miss him all the way to the end of our days, but we're not too far away from joining him. Psalm 16 I've chosen. In the fifth verse, the Lord is my inheritance, my cup. You are the one who determines my destiny. Your boundary lines mark out pleasant places for me. Indeed, my inheritance is something beautiful. I will praise the Lord. He advises me. My conscience warns me at night. I always keep the Lord right in front of me. When he's by my side, I cannot be moved. That is why my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body rests securely because you do not abandon my soul to the grave or allow your holy ones to decay. You make the path of life known to me. You complete joy is in your presence, and your pleasures are by my side forever. And then just this one line out of Psalm 17, keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. And that's just what has happened in Jesus Christ. Kept like the apple of his eye and hidden in the very closeness of his wings. Thank you.
These guys are obviously taller than I am. Although if you know our family is pretty short. Oh, there we go. Okay. I want to thank Ron and Erskine for the kind words. And I'm gonna apologize up front. I am not a public speaker. I'm just hoping I can get through this without completely breaking down. But on behalf of my mom and my sisters, Tammy, Tara, and Tracy, I'd like to thank you all for coming this morning. And for those who are watching online, I knew I couldn't write something for this. So I asked my sisters and my nieces and my nephews to send me a couple of their favorite memories of Dad. So to give you a little insight on how it was for us and for our kids growing up. Now, one thing you may or may not know is both my parents are only children, so we didn't have any aunts or uncles, we didn't have any first cousins growing up, so we were the only grandkids of both sets of grandparents, so we grew up in a very tight-knit family. And there are so many great memories of Dad, but I'm going to start with one of mine. When I was in the fifth or sixth grade, Dad and Grandpa had hound dogs that we used to take raccoon hunting. We would hunt in the areas near where we lived, and I was had a great time doing it. And just to clarify, Dad wasn't actually born in Flat Rock. He was actually born in a little house a couple miles outside of town, and it was actually not far from where we lived. One night we were hunting near that house, and we'd actually parked a truck there in front of it. And as we were wandering around the woods and cornfields and listening for the dogs, we ended up some distance away from the truck. It was getting late, so Dad decided we should head back to the truck and then call the dogs in. So he took off, and I followed him. And after a time, I asked him where we were going, and he said, back to the truck. And it was a clear night, and the stars were out, and I actually thought this truck was in the other direction. But I figured, he's Dad. He knows where he's going. And we walked a little farther, and I asked him again where he was going. He said, we're going back to the truck. And then I asked him, I said, what direction do you think we're going in? And he said, we're going east. And I said, well, look at the stars. I said, we're going northwest. And he looked up and he realized his mistake, so we turned around and went back to the truck. And it's always amazed me that he could get lost less than a mile from where he was born, and it was actually less than 2 miles from where we lived. So Tammy sent me the following, and I will say there's some of these stories you're going to hear from two different people that have a different take on it. So Tammy sent me the following, Tam. He called me Tam. He taught me how to fish, taught me how to cast a line at John Mitchell's pond, and we caught sunfish. He took us fishing in the Flat Rock River. He would tie a rope to a yellow rubber raft and then around his waist and put the three of us in there. He would put on his hip waders and take us fishing with him. I think I was there to make sure Trent didn't fall out of the raft, which was probably true. He loved it when he caught a fish that had eggs in it. I remember him coating the eggs with cornmeal and frying them up to eat. He taught me how to ride my bike and how to do a cartwheel right there in the front yard. He says, I couldn't believe he could do it. The first time I saw him cry was at Meemaw's funeral, which was his grandmother. I was 11, and that really shook me. One of the only times I saw him get mad at anyone but us kids was at the crazy old man who lived across the road from us at Flat Rock. Dad all of a sudden went cussing, waving his arms, ranting across the road at him. I was so shocked at his actions and his cussing. When I asked him what happened, he said that he was so mad. I asked him what happened that he was so mad. Dad said the old man was drunk, waving a gun around, and we had been outside playing, and Dad was protecting us. I don't remember that. I remember when he and the Flat Rock vigilantes did a stakeout at Doc Davis's office and actually caught the guys who were robbing it. He would go mushroom hunting in the spring and rabbit hunting with Leon Kendall on Thanksgiving mornings. Once on family vacation, not paying attention, he stepped backwards right into the swimming pool. He went in shoes, clothes, glasses, wallet, everything. I remember the $10 bills hanging in the bathroom to dry. He paid the supper bill with damp money and told the waitress not to ask. We all laughed so hard that day. Well, Tara has a different perspective on that. On another time on a trip, we were all trying to get our swimsuits on to go out to the pool. The others were going in and out of the door while I was trying to get ready. I was probably 12 or 13 at the time. I was so mad at everyone leaving the door open. Dad looked at me and said, if they haven't seen it before, they're not going to know what it is. And if they have, they've seen better. Thanks, Dad. Some of my childhood friends have told me they still remember him saying that to them, too. Okay. We didn't have air conditioning growing up in the house in Flat Rock. I remember him sitting in the brown leather lazy boy in his white tidy whiteys at night watching TV. Tracy would get so embarrassed when I would bring my dates in when they brought me home. My dates never seemed to mind, though. I think everybody's dad did that back then. I would stay up late on the weekends and watch late night movies with him on Sammy Terry, which was the horror guy in Indianapolis. Wolfman, Frankenstein, Dracula, and the Creature from Black Lagoon. We would set up lawn chairs in the backyard in the summer, sometimes in the winter, to watch the stars, the meteor showers, and lunar eclipses. When he would toot, he'd say, watch out for those tree frogs. He was so happy that Zach, his first grandchild, was born on his birthday. That's very true. When I was 7.5 months pregnant with Alyssa, I fell and injured my heel. I had to be on crutches for a while, and when he saw me, he said, talk about a cow on crutches. He loved to come to Alyssa's gymnastics meet. He was with me when she won the state meet. He would come to the boys' soccer and basketball games. I remember the night he called the referee a pork chop as he ran by. I think all those years he kept score for the high school games, he knew he would have to keep quiet. That's probably very true. He loved to rock the babies and sing that silly Bayou Bayou song if you ever heard him rock, that was. He seemed to know everybody and everybody knew him. Everywhere we went, somehow he would find a connection to someone he knew. He could make friends with just about anyone, as Ron and Erskine have alluded to, except for that old man across the street. And everybody seemed to like him, and we all loved him. So that was from Tammy. One other memory of mine that will always stand out is when the whole family took a Millennium Cruise to 1999-2000, and the ship had advertised a costume contest that whoever won would get a free cruise. And I don't know how he did it, but my brother-in-law Steve dressed up as Robin Hood, and he convinced Dad to go as Maid Marian. And Dad was dressed in a bright pink dress with a long pointy hat and a veil, so it was kind of hard to see his face. And they didn't win, unfortunately. But later in the casino that night, Dad was playing roulette, I think, and he struck up a conversation with the guy next to him. And Dad said the guy later admitted that he wasn't sure if Dad was a male or female for a while. But But he was finally convinced that he was male when he saw Dad's big Masonic ring on his finger. I think I would have been more concerned about the 5 o'clock shadow, but Tammy's son, Zach, sent me the following memory. He said, every time Grandpa would come to visit in Madison when I was a teen, we would stay out until after dark shooting basketball. It also took me into my 20s to beat him at golf, which I'll add that meant Dad was in his 70s. He said, I could out-hit him for miles but couldn't close. He knew how to get in my head. At the time, it was so annoying and frustrating, but in hindsight, it was extremely fun and still my favorite memories of Grandpa. My son Travis sent me a message saying he remembered Dad taking him to the Columbus Airport for breakfast so they could watch the planes take off and land. My daughter Tony said she had been thinking about all the summer trips that Mom and Dad had taken them on, but she kept coming back to when we were living in Indiana at the time when they were little. Mom and Dad had moved to Columbus at that point, and their community had a pool. And Dad would take them swimming and always try to teach them to dive properly. She said he would make them do it over and over until she would almost get mad at him. As a little kid, it's strange the things like that you remember. Tammy's daughter, Alyssa, said her most prominent memory was going to Columbus in the summer, going swimming, Dad teaching them to dive. It seems like there was a theme in those days. My daughter, Taylor, didn't have any specific memories, but she did say one thing Dad told her early on when she was learning to play euchre. He said, never turn down a right bower. And if you played euchre with Dad, you know it killed him if you ever had to turn down a right bower. Tracy and Steve's daughter, Madison, sent me a note that her favorite memory was when she was commissioned in the Air Force, that Dad gave her her first salute. Sorry about that. I was actually there, and it was a special moment. So this is the part that's going to get tough, because I saved Tara's part for last, because she's obviously the best writer of all of us. She wrote, if you read Dad's obituary, she wrote most of that. Okay, she writes, memories of all the family vacations come in bits and pieces over the years. It was always filled with anticipation, Dad cleaning the station wagon, packing all the suitcases, folding down the seats so we could get the blankets in the right way for us to sleep on the first early morning on the road. We would be in Terre Haute by the time we woke up and wanted breakfast. He loved taking pictures and was always trying to get the perfect one of us kids in front of a beautiful landscape or a monument or a character at Disneyland. He always said the redwoods frustrated him the most because he could never get a shot with the whole tree, but still have something small enough for perspective. The best memory, though, was when he was trying to get Tracy to slide down the slide in the pool. She was at the top, he wouldn't actually slide until Dad moved away from the slide. He took a step back, she said, back up further. So he took another step back and then decided to take that one more step and ended up taking the most perfect nesty plunge you had ever seen, fully clothed, cowboy boots, everything. Again, we had to drip dry the dollar bills, and the waitress, when we checked out, or when he paid for dinner, kind of looked at him kind of funny, and he said, yeah, don't ask. More than anything, though, it is just Dad being the best Dad. The games of pitch and catch after he came home from work, being there at every ball game, every band concert, every drama club play, every graduation, every significant life event. Him tapping out our names in Morse code at the supper table in the evenings as he tried to remember his radioman skills from his time in the Army. Teaching us how to shoot free throws on the hoop over the garage. And he made 10 out of 10 at age 40, age 50, age 60, supporting our dreams, supporting our friends, supporting the Flat Rock community. He was a volunteer fireman for several years and would occasionally take us along to sit in the car while they worked to put out a neighbor's barn or a haystack fire. He He attended PTA meetings at the old Flower Rock School where he graduated from, and we, as kids, went as an elementary school. He helped the Firemen's helped with the Firemen's Fall Festivals and the annual Firemen's Fish Fries. He attended the Norristown Masonic Lodge meetings, taking us to the annual oyster suppers, which we whined about because none of us like oysters. But he wanted to get the oyster stew. Fortunately, they did have ham sandwiches there also. I remember when he headed to Tennessee on a firecracker run with one of his cousins. Sounded like the cannonball run even back then. So we could enjoy bottle rockets and Roman candles on July 4th, even though they were illegal in Indiana at the time. Watching the Boston Pops together on the 4th of July evening after the fireworks display and waiting on them to bust out in the 1812 Overture and Stars and Stripes Forever. Summer August nights in our lawn chairs in the backyard watching the Perseid meteor shower was always a highlight of the summer vacation before we started again. He loved the 4th of July, but it was still second to Christmas. There was nothing more joyful about life for Dad than to have the family together at Christmas. I think Grandma Wertz must have instilled that sense of love and wonder in him at an early age because he never lost it. And it was most special when we welcomed a new baby on his or her first Christmas. Dad loved rocking babies, holding babies, making them laugh and smile. All the grandkids and great-grandkids that came along have some memory hidden away of being bio'd by Dad rocking them at some point in their new lives. So whether you are family by blood, family by marriage, family by love, or family by friendship, Dad was always willing to spend time with family. So on behalf of Mom and my sisters and our whole family, thank you for being part of his life and sharing his love.
The family wanted a small, quick time. If there's anybody's got like 2 or 3 minutes, we got 15 minutes is all we're allotted. But if you got something you'd like to say, if you'd come over this mic, just 2 or 3 minutes, come up now and come on, yeah.
Is this on?
Yeah.
Is it on? Okay. All right, I'll make this very quick. I'm going to tell a story, believe it or not, it doesn't have anything to do with golf. I've played golf with Ted for 16 years. And I appreciate the fact that he let me be part of his family. But this story has to do with a Saturday afternoon. I was home watching TV, and my phone rings, and I look, and it says Ted Wertz. So as usual, I pick it up. I go, Teddy. He goes, Mikey. And all while he's talking to me, I hear this click, 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 click. I says, what are you doing? He says, oh, I got to change the switch in the bathroom. Oh, I says, well, good luck with that. He says, well, I got to turn off all the power in the house to do it. I says, I'll be there in 5 minutes. So I get over to the house. He meets me at the door with the switch. Click, 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 click. I says, give me that thing. We go into the bathroom, take the cover off, take the old switch off. I separate the wires. I says, Ted, check that hot wire, see if we got a circuit. And he goes like that. He says, I ain't doing that. So anyway, we get it all fixed. I go home. 2 weeks later, I'm home, get a phone call, Ted. Teddy, what's going on? Mikey, click, 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 click. I said, what are you doing? He said, I got another switch. I said, did you break that switch I put in? He said, no, this is the other bathroom. So I said, I'll be there in 5 minutes. So I go over, get it all together again, said, check that to make sure we got a circuit. I ain't doing that. So we get that changed, and as I'm walking out of the house, I look in the other bathroom, and there's towels all around the toilet in the other bathroom. I says, what's going on here? All the insides plugged up, and he says, it doesn't work right. I says, well, let me go get the guts to it, and I said, I'll replace it. Oh, I got that in the garage. I said, okay, so we got it, got that all fixed up. And then about 4 weeks later, we're playing dominoes at their house. And they go to look at something in the back bedroom there at the house. And as they go in there, Ted says, well, turn the light on over there. He says, that rheostat doesn't work. I says, well, Ted, you should have told me, we could have got it. Oh, it's in the garage. So we go out there, we get that, we replace all that. Now, my point to this is one is, does that not sound like your dad? The other is, if the good Lord ever asked me what not to have Ted do is do plumbing and electrical work. But I loved him dearly. He was a great friend. And by the way, oh, Ron's not here anymore, but when the smoke would come out of those cigars, the EPA was following them down the fairway. So anyway, God love you. You're a beautiful family, and every family should take examples from you.
I was going through some pictures, and Dave, I think, has got them up there for me. And I generally put labels on my pictures, and this picture is us sharing some Arizona dry heat. You know, and you can tell that we're really warm in that picture. The second picture is really the one I wanted to get to anyway. And this goes down on a historic moment. We were in a foursome and we were playing, and there was two of us on the green waiting for them to come up to the green. And they're back in the pond there, and you notice that they've got a golf ball retriever, okay? And most of you know what that is. It's a golf ball retriever to retrieve a golf ball. Well, Ted's not trying to retrieve a golf ball here. He's trying to retrieve his golf club. So I just couldn't let that go. I had to let. Anyway, I, like a number of other guys, played a lot of golf with Ted, and we had a lot of good times, and he was a lot of fun, as has been said here before, that we just had a great time every time we were together. Thank you.
I don't see anybody, so anybody else? Okay. Jesus said, stand back from the mic, what he said. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. If it were not, in my Father's house are many rooms, and if it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will return and take you to myself so you may be where I am. And you know the way I'm going. Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." As we come today to say goodbye to this good, God-fearing man, I want the words of Jesus to try and comfort us. Like in the opening prayer that I said, that we have a God that knows how to comfort us in each affliction that we go through. And all of us today that we're his friends, his family, there's a small part of us that's gone. And there's just a hole in our heart. But the Comforter will never seal or completely fill that hole, but he will comfort us through here, through this time that we're going through. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled." In the Greek, in the most text, it says hearts. But the Greek actually says heart. It's singular. Jesus is being very personable here. Each one of us, including and more today, Ted, he wanted to comfort Ted and his family. But death has a way of troubling us, does it not? And just by the very nature, death is troubling. It's unknown. Uncertainty what we do next. Ted knows, but he can't tell us. So it's troubling. And by all standards, it's the most dreaded thing that we go through. But Jesus says, don't let your heart be troubled or agitated, because you believe in God and you believe in me also. God brings us that comfort today. We receive comfort when we realize that this world is not our home. The great C.S. Lewis said, if we really think that home is elsewhere, and that this life is just a wandering to find our home, why should we not look forward to the arrival of getting to that home? Jesus said that he goes to prepare a place for us, and in his Father's place there's many mansions. For heaven to us is many mansions. It's not just a home. It's not a room. It's a mansion. And the home speaks of God's provision. There's a room for each one of us, especially made for us by him. A weary traveler, one of the most troubling and dreaded signs for a weary traveler is no vacancy. That is not the sign we will see in heaven. There's always room in his house. And this speaks for God's care for his own. We receive comfort in knowing that Jesus is returning for us. Death is simply a waiting room where we wait for that great reunion. And Jesus says, if I go to prepare a place for you, I will return and take you to be where I am also. We detest saying words like goodbye because it means that the event is over. We say things like, I'll see you later. We'll do this again sometime. But we know that it's not always a certainty. Plans change. Lives turn. But Jesus said, I will return. This speaks of his love for us. This speaks of our value. We receive comfort today in knowing that we have a destination. Thomas said, we don't know where you're going, Lord. How can we know the way? And with just three words, Jesus told us about our destination, which will give us comfort we need in days such as these. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The way is his path, Jesus' path, to follow. And Ted Wertz followed that path. One of the last time that I saw Ted, he just moved to the care unit there and where they live, and I went over to see him, and Roz says, well, he's sort of in and out of it. He's sort of asleep and not asleep. And I said, well, don't wake him up. She said, oh, Mike, or she said, Ted, Mike's here. He opened up his eyes, said, hi, bud. I said, hi, how you doing? I've been better, huh? And then he sort of nodded off to sleep, and me and Ross, we walked over to the other side of the room, and there was a couch there. We were sitting on the couch, and we were just chit-chatting, and we got to discuss. I think she got a spam call on her telephone, and I said something like, I can't wait till this election season gets over. I swear I get all these, and then we hear from the other side of the room that Ted, while he was asleep, said, don't swear. And we both laughed. So, Ted, I'm not going to swear. I'm not the old man across the street. The truth. There is no shadows when it comes to following God's way. He is truth. When he says he loves us, he does. When he says he cares for us, he does. When he says he'll return for us, he will. I never fail to mention this story when I'm doing right now for a deeply Christian man or woman. I have to tell a story, and so I will. There's a story of two sisters and a brother. Now, the brother was Jesus's good friend, and he was sick. So the two sisters sent a messenger to tell Jesus to come and to heal their brother. And Jesus had done that many, many times. He had even just said the word, and a Roman centurion's servant was healed from a distance. He had touched people and they were healed. There's a woman that just touched the hem of his robe and she was healed. But Jesus did something different this time. He did nothing. He didn't go to his friends. He stayed away. And his friend died. Then Jesus said, let's go to our friend who's fallen asleep. And as he was walking in the town, they told Martha that Jesus was on his way, and she ran to him. And she said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that God hears you and will do what you say. Jesus said, you know you'll see your brother again. And she said, yes. Yes, I will. I know. At the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus says, in my opinion, one of the strongest sayings of the New Testament. He looked at Martha and said, I am the resurrection. I am the life. And whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. And he looked at Martha and said, do you believe this? And she said, yes. I believe you are the Lord, the Messiah, who has come. Well, the other day, I got to tell the end of the story. You all know it. They went to the tomb then. And he yelled, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus walked out of the tomb. The other day, Jesus called. He went to Ted, his treasured possession, his child, the one that he's loved, the one he had made a place for, and he didn't say, come out. Jesus simply said, come home. And he did. We got two more songs to sing. I messed up the rotation, but we got two songs to sing. The first one is going to be How Great Thou Art, and then we're going to sing as a dismissal a peppier song, a song that Ted's enjoying now because he has flown away. He has flown away. Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for the Christ that you sent that saves us all from our sins. I thank you for calling your precious child, Ted, home. And I thank you for then sending the Comforter to us to mend that hole that's in our hearts. Never, never, never let us forget the stories. We need to always tell the stories, because when we do, Ted stays alive with us here. But he's waiting for us there. Showing us how great you are. I thank you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. announcement. There is a lunch in the fellowship hall. Please go have a bite, share a story, say hi to the family if you will. And so I'm going to pray for that food and pray for our dismissal. Father, we pray for the food that has been provided. We pray for the hands that prepared it, the hands that will and take it, and that you will use the food to nourish our bodies, to go out and do as Ted did, to be encouraging, to be funny, to share your love, Lord, to share your love. We thank you so much for that. We thank you for this family together. Keep Ted alive in our hearts, Lord, and it is the name of the Christ I pray. Amen. You are dismissed.